BlackRapid Radio.
Welcome to BlackRapid Radio. I have a special guest in here today. You've seen his work at the Guitar Center. He's been shooting rock and roll since the 60s. And we've got Robert M. Knight in the studio today. And I'm just really thrilled to meet you today, Robert.
Yeah, thank you. I'm glad to be here in Seattle, one of my favorite cities.
Well, I'm glad you're here, too. And you hit it on a nice day. And you were at Guitar Center today.
Yeah, I photographed two young female guitar players that I'm profiling in a website project I'm doing with Fender and Guitar Center called The Brotherhood of the Guitar. And we're looking for, you know, just great role models for young girls to pick up the guitar. And we're using these girls as examples of where you can go with it.
Well, ever since the documentary came out, and that's Rock Prophecy, if you haven't seen it, man, please go see it. It's a great story, and it shows his work, and it shows Robert how he connects to musicians, especially ones early on before they get well known. And this is Robert's passion.
Yeah.
Music and photography. So,
yeah.
So tell me a little bit about what happened after the documentary. And the documentary came out in 2009
or 2010. It was very interesting because Seattle played a very key part of how we were able to do the film. We started it with a very small budget, and then Samsung wrote us a check for $1 million, which had never happened before. Wow. To an independent film without distribution. And through that money, we were able to get music licensing, shoot all over the world, and put on some pretty good parties at film festivals, which I think we won four film festivals. You know, we won Dallas AFI. I think we won something in Nashville. I mean, we've done pretty well with it. It never went into major wide distribution because independent documentary films normally don't go into theaters, but we were on heavy rotation on PBS, and we're still on PBS, and we're on Netflix. So it's almost like this movie continues to
to grow.
It's like this movie continues to be current, and I get deluged with emails every week from young musicians or young people referring people to me. And the backstory in the movie was my dealing with my mother and Alzheimer's. So I also get a lot of emails from people close to my age who are going through the same experience with their parents. And we're sort of a support mechanism for each other. It's kind of interesting.
Well, you know, your life has taken off in a whole new direction since this film. And did you realize maybe this film would create this kind of stir for you to get bombarded in those two ways of with your mother and with people trying to send you CDs?
No, I mean, I didn't even want to do the film because originally a friend of mine brought me to the producer of Will and Grace and Seinfeld, and he was interested in doing a reality show on Ronnie Wood from the Rolling Stones. And I know Ronnie and I work with Ronnie, and he brought me in as somebody that would know Ronnie. So basically I talked the director out of it. I said, basically, it would not be good for the Rolling Stones or Ronnie Wood to do this just because of things that were going on in his life and Mick Jagger, you know, wanting to get tour insurance and things like this. So he said, well, what do you do? And I said, well, I'm a photographer. And he's like, well, who have you photographed? And I said, well, you know, I was the first guy to photograph Led Zeppelin in America and the last guy to shoot Stevie Ray. And I worked with Jimi Hendrix. And he's like, well, let's do a reality show on you. And I went, no, I just like, I hate reality TV. Yeah, it's terrible. Yeah. And I said, no. And he kept going and going and going and kept calling. And I told my wife, and she's like, well, we'll just get divorced now because anybody that does reality show gets divorced, you know? But he said, well, what would you do? And I said, well, I'd be willing to do a documentary where I could talk about the people that blessed me by allowing me to photograph them, because why am I important? These are the people that were important. So I got Slash, Jeff Beck, Santana, Def Leppard, ZZ Top. I mean, pretty much anybody I ever worked with agreed to be in the film. And I got their music. Jimi Hendrix's sister gave me the music for Hendrix. I have original music from Stevie Ray. And most documentaries cannot get these. You know, this is very hard to get original music.
For some reason, you know, you've somewhere along the road that you've built all this catalog of musicians and the photography, but you must really, they trust you, don't they? I mean, there's this bond between you and the musicians that they trust you to go, hey, I need some of your music and I'm doing this film. They know whatever you get involved in that. Hey, I'm in too, you know?
Yeah, I mean, I think the key thing is, and there's a lot of problems with photographers for a lot of rock stars, and that is where the photographer becomes more important than the person that he's photographing or she's photographing. So a lot of times the rock stars are offended by, quote, famous photographers, because it sort of takes away from what they're about. Mm. And then the other thing is, once you can get through that, they trust you not to put out bad pictures or take advantage of situations that you see that could be, you know, not in their best interest that those photos get out.
Well, and let me just follow up on that one. And in the film, you've talked about, you were the last person to photograph Stevie as he was leaving the...
Yeah, I mean, Stevie was a friend of mine. I met him on tour with Jeff Beck, and he was sober. I only knew Stevie sober. And I was probably the only person he had ever met who has never done a single drug in my life. And he bonded with me on that. And he's like, well, how could you have done all these tours with Led Zeppelin and stay at the Edgewater and never have done any drugs? And I'm like, I just was never interested. So he invited me to come shoot this special concert in his life where he was going to play with Eric Clapton. And we were going to do a poster for Fender with him and Eric and Robert Cray and Jimmy Vaughn. And I got that gig. And so the first day, Eric forgot that we were doing it. It was a 2-day show. So he said, Robert, don't shoot today. I'll let all the press photographers shoot. Tomorrow, you could be the only guy.
Nice.
50,000 people. And then that next day turned out to be very prophetic. And these pictures became valuable the next day when Stevie had died. And I wouldn't let him out. 2 years I sat on those photos before I let him out, because it was blood money. It was like pictures of your friend in a car wreck. And you're like, no, I'm not going to sell that.
Right. That shows a side to you. I think a lot of people would understand now how I could trust you. You know that you're not really in this for the money, are you?
Well, no, because you see, that's sort of the paparazzi thing. Because if you saw the kind of money you could get for a single shot of Paris Hilton doing something naughty, I mean, it's a couple hundred grand.
Yeah.
And so there is this frenzy of people that it's like finding money in the street. So they persist in just stalking all these celebrities. And when I'm around people that get stalked, I actually asked if I could take my camera out of the bag. Because every time I see Tommy Lee, I'm like, Tommy, you remember me? Yes. I'm going to take my camera out of the bag. It's okay, Robert. You know, because normally he's hitting photographers, you know. So there's a few people. But I always ask first. And then if I'm with a famous person and someone wants their picture taken with that person, I say, you ask him. I'm not asking him. If he's wanting to take a picture with you, then I will do it. But you ask that person. So I throw the onus back on them.
I liked the little story about when you were backstage with the Rolling Stones and Keith Richards, I believe, that was giving you the glare.
Oh, yeah. Well, I was told by the promoter to stay out of the dressing room, because in Hawaii, I could do whatever I want because I grew up there and I could pretty much go into any dressing room at any concert. But the local promoter said, under no circumstance, go into the Rolling Stones dressing room. So I was standing outside and Bill Graham, who was the bigger promoter, looked at me and said, I told you to go sit in the dressing room, get in there right now. And I'm like, so I sat in there and it was Keith Richards, a bottle of Jack, some guns, some knives, you know, whatever he had going on in there. And I'm like, oh my God, this is the definitive shot of Keith Richards. So I went for the camera bag and Keith's like, no, you're not going to pull it out. And he doesn't know why I was in the room. And
yeah,
you know, and I'm just sitting there watching him drink and strum the guitar. And I was like, wow, this is cool.
Oh my God.
I told him that story years later when I saw him at a party.
So you've got a long list of musicians and tell me a little bit about the Led Zeppelin days.
Oh, well, Led Zeppelin, you see, when I was a kid growing up in Hawaii, I found some music magazines, and my dad was a Baptist minister, and I didn't go to movies, concerts, nothing. And this would have been around like 64, 65. I picked these magazines up and they were full of long-haired people in very weird clothing. And I'm like, what is this? And they all had weird names. So I noticed in the back of this British magazine, you could send away for these records. So I got them and had them before they actually came out in America and played them on my high school PA system during the lunch hour before everybody even knew what a DJ was. So I was playing the Rolling Stones, the Pretty Things, the Yardbirds, and I couldn't play guitar, you know? And I was like, how do I get around these guys? And I didn't know, but I wanted to go to England because this British invasion was happening. So I figured out how to be a travel agent. And at 16, I flew to England first class free and ended up, you know, on the set of the movie Blow Up, which was about a photographer shooting rock bands. And that was it. The bell went off in my head. And I said, I have to go back to Hawaii and buy a camera and teach myself.
Wow.
So I did it really quickly. The Vietnam War was going on. My parents said, you're going to have to pick a college. I was reading in a magazine that all those bands that I liked were going to play the summer of 68 at the Fillmore for Bill Graham. So I looked around and figured out there was a photography school in San Francisco. And I said, this is where I need to go to school, San Francisco Art Institute. So that was how that happened. My classmate was Annie Leibovitz.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah, she was in the same class as me. And I knew Jan Weiner from Hawaii, you know, the editor of Rolling Stone. And I'd go in there and I'd say, send me to L.A. There's this band I want to photograph. And he's like, who is it? And I go, the New Yardbirds. He goes, no, I don't like that band. I said, please send me. So he sent me to L.A. The band had to change their name because the Yardbird name was owned by someone else. So I show up and they're now called Led Zeppelin. And I go there and like, I'm here to shoot for Rolling Stone. They go, how old are you? And I said, like, I'm 17 or 18. They go, you can't get in. You got to be 21. I'm like, listen, I'm with Rolling Stone. I got to get in. And they called the hotel. Jimmy Page answered the phone. And he said, well, send him over here to the hotel. So I spent all day with Led Zeppelin and they brought me in as road crew.
Oh, nice.
And then I called my friend in Hawaii, who was the promoter, and I said, Tom, book this band. They are going to be huge. He took my word for it. I quit school, went back to Hawaii, and then picked him up at the Honolulu airport in my Volkswagen. I have a very famous shot of Led Zeppelin in front of a Pan Am jet in 1969 on their first tour. They're holding the master tapes to Led Zeppelin 2 in their arms, which they were working on as they were touring. So right from the get-go, they saw me as like a crucial early on supporter of the band, and I still see them all. You know, I still see everybody. So,
wow.
Yeah.
I can't even believe these stories. And they don't end here because, you know, you've got a whole new thing going on now.
Yeah. Because of the movie, there's a certain amount of celebrity that comes with anytime you do anything on movies or on television, somehow you're important. And I was very uncomfortable with that situation, and people recognized me. You know, when I go through airports, customs people stop me on the streets in England and in all over the place and say, oh, I saw that movie. And it was very irritating for me because as a photographer, it's best to stay anonymous.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, when I go out on tour with like Aerosmith, now people will stop me in the middle of a concert and ask me to autograph a ticket or something. And I'm and Steven Tyler's like, what are you doing? You know, I was like, what's going on over here? You know, but so I thought, listen, if there's anything you can do, if you have fame, and that's deflect it. So because I have, you know, an interesting story and I've done a lot of interviews or television shows or whatever, I can now talk about another topic and people will talk to me about it. And that is my passion for young guitar players. So I went to Fender and I went to Guitar Center and I said, look, I'm getting all these emails. There's all these kids and there's no role models for young kids because all the guys that are really good are about 70, you know? And they need to find kids their own age that they can relate to. So both companies agreed that they would support this. And I have been funded to go all over the world and look for boys and girls that are emerging. And I've been in Holland and Canada, and I got people in India and the Philippines. And I've created literally a brotherhood. And my goal is to let them network with each other, use any fame I have or any corporate money I can get to put on shows. And a whole bunch of my kids just went to New York and played for Eric Clapton's Crossroads. And we do events with Guitar Center and Fender. So it's working. It's a kind of a viral village up.
Yeah. Well, the momentum is starting to really happen here for you. And this has been 2 years of you starting this. Yeah. And so you brought a couple of girls into the studio today.
Yeah, I was in Seattle to shoot Haley McLean from Vancouver, who literally is like a female Keith Urban or Brad Paisley on the Telecaster. She is amazing. And I've been recently turned on to a local Seattle girl who lives in the San Juan Islands, who's a singer-songwriter who is just utterly amazing in her passionate, lyrical way that which she sings. And she's only just 18 and she's just, you know, just fully evolved as a musician. Just amazing.
And you're trying to, like you told me earlier, that you're looking for musicians that are up and coming in their teens, basically.
Yes.
That's kind of where you're really targeting. Like, well, 13, because you said.
Yeah, I mean, I get them on, I actually get kids 12, but I kind of wait till they're 13. And then I'm COPPA compliant on the website, which means we don't, you know, data mine children or send them direct emails. But I kind of like their parents will contact me. And if the parents contact me, then I will reach out. You know, we try to create an atmosphere where, you know, without giving away where they live or something like this. So they're protected.
Safe,
but you know, these kids are learning how to songwrite with other people. They find drummers or bass players. We put on concerts in Nashville where 8 or 9 of them will come from around the country and play. And we, you know, like Keith Urban and Derek Trucks and Warren Haynes came out in New York to support a couple of my young kids the other day and cheer them on. I mean, it was pretty amazing. God. Dan Aykroyd introduced them. I mean, they were stoked. Right? Yeah.
So, Robert, you got one of your girls that you come across that's you're helping promote and build her.
Emery Franklin, and she's actually a local girl from Seattle. She lives in the San Juan Islands. And I heard about her from a producer in Nashville that had listened to her record some EP material up there. And he called me and he said, take a look.
It's a quiet goodbye, because it lasts a long time. There's no screaming down floors.
I took a look and called her and flew to Seattle the next day.
That's how soon.
That's how quickly. That's, I said, can you play the guitar? I'm coming.
I've learned that life around Robert and I is quick. Everything happens very fast.
I like that. And he's the follow-through guy.
Yeah.
Yeah. He says something. He's there.
Yeah. I met him for, 2 days. And he says, well, do you want to come meet Tyler Bryant, in Vegas this weekend? This weekend? Yeah, this weekend.
Why mess around?
Exactly.
Oh, so, you want to go down to the set of CSI? Next day, she's at the set of CSI with the producer. She met with the manager of the Sick Puppies, Paul Stepanek. She got to see a band called Rival Sons, which are emerging really big right now in Europe, and all that in 48 hours.
Mm-hmm.
tell me about the whole process when you first heard from Robert and how that all went down. Because did you know Robert before he had contacted you?
No. So I got a Facebook message from our mutual friend, the producer that Robert met. And he said, my buddy's looking at you, just this is who he is if he calls or something. So he calls me up and just says, I'm doing the Brotherhood. I'm looking for females. I think you would fit. And then it just went from there. And it was all within, 5 hours.
Jeez. Did you think it was going to be anything big, or did you have a feeling that this is my big break, or was you just taking it kind of casual, or?
I didn't really know. I didn't really know what to think. I just respected our mutual friend and what he had to say. And then I found out about Rock Prophecies, and I watched Rock Prophecies and, visualized. I saw who Robert was and his passion behind what he does and his belief in young talent. And then I got really excited.
Well, that movie really actually reflects a lot of Robert's personality, because the care that you with your mother was a very touching story, and selling your collection.
Hendrix. Yeah, the Hendrix negatives.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And, Robert, when you watch that movie and you get out of that movie, you go, this guy has a big heart. There's, these people are rare in the business where you can feel like you could trust them and stuff.
So. I loved the interview with the Sick Puppies, Shim saying, I want to make it sometimes, not so much for myself, just for how much Robert believes in us.
Yeah, I know. That was a great scene.
I love that line.
Yeah. Because he was getting, well, even Robert was, when he was talking about, like, sell the farm, whatever it takes to get here, and then he goes, make a little nervous about that.
Yeah, he calls me from time to time because they've had 8 top 40 singles since the movie.
Wow.
And they debuted their album on Jay Leno, which was part of the thing that, we were able to do with them and help them. But he'll call me now that they're touring and everything. And he goes, does this get any better? Is there do I get happier during this? And I go, no, actually, this is about as happy as you're going to get. It actually kind of sucks from here on out, because it becomes a big corporate treadmill, and now is the test. But the days of climbing or coming up are the good old days, not the day when you get the top of the peak and then worrying about going back down, because the fall is much faster than the ride back up.
Does the work get a lot harder too? It seems like the hard part is building your brand.
Building the brand, but then the manager has to push the artist to the point of insanity, and then you just bring it back one notch. Because it takes 2 to 3 years to break. And it's a treadmill of endless concert, endless lack of sleep, endless sound checks, endless radio interviews and this sort of thing, talking to program directors, and eventually there's some momentum. But in that sleep deprivation and in that moment of other frustration,
Wait, that's it. What am I up against here?
You see it with the sick puppies in that movie. You see these kids who are absolutely tired. And, you know, a band called Wolf Mother, who are friends of mine, literally two of them ended up in mental hospitals, and the singer managed to get through it. But I mean, literally, the managers will push. And so I actually manage now. And my whole thing is I'm more worried about the mental health of the artist than how much money we can make. And I think that's a better position to take, because the mental health issues for young artists in this business don't work out usually.
Is that what makes a lot of people go to drugs and suicide, is because of all the pressures?
I mean, there's a social thing with drugs and alcohol that comes with the party that goes with the band. But what I try to explain to any young artist is this is a business. And you have to approach it like a business. So if you were opening a grocery store or a clothing store, you wouldn't have your CFO on drugs. You wouldn't let your maintenance people and all the different people show up stoned at work. Why would you do that in a band? That makes no sense, because you're going to at some point go, where did the money go? Because everybody's going to steal from you when you're in a situation like that. So all these famous people I know all have horrible stories about being ripped off, losing their publishing. I mean, the number of big bands right now that don't own their own publishing. I mean, the Rolling Stones don't own their first 12 records. They can't explain how they lost them.
Wow.
You know, so Mick Jagger took control, stopped the drugs and partying, and became the business manager and rebuilt the brand. But a lot of bands can't do that.
But do you see that changing now? I mean, were you following a certain band, or was there anything that influenced your life?
I was kind of an anomaly among my family, and I don't have any music influence within, you know, my upbringing. I was just kind of the annoying kid that was singing Disney songs when I was three. So I don't know. I just, you know,
are you playing anywhere, like little coffee shops and stuff over there? Or
I mean, yeah, I started music and guitar is my ability to get out my poems that I've been writing, because I've always been a writer. And then when I was nine, I picked up the guitar. And then from there on, it's been writing, singing, you know, playing all the local fairs, coffee shops, all of the above, you know, the basic startup. And then I started recording when I was 14.
Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
And how old are you now?
I'm 18.
18. And so are you excited about all this? I mean, Robert just laid out of all this work and no sleep and stuff. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
But you have to treat it like you're in the Olympics. Like, I just did 11 shows with Def Leppard. And, you know, Phil Collins has a personal trainer. He works out three times a day. You know, he's a vegan. They juice. I mean, there isn't the drug and there isn't that culture going on. But, you know, you have to almost approach it as if you are in the Olympics, because you are running a kind of marathon. And if you start to, like, get heavy into the booze and drugs and things like that, your body will deteriorate and you're not going to be able to keep up. And and you see this all the time
and
with bands.
You'll lose all your money that you
know, Green Day just had to cancel a huge year tour because the lead singer went out of his mind, you know?
Who was that?
Green Day. Mm-hmm. Billy Joe ended up being, you know, put away for a little while, right? In the middle of a show in Vegas, he had a breakdown on stage and went off on Justin Bieber, which is understandable, but, you know, now Justin Bieber's having a breakdown, you know, pretty much, you know, the mental health of these kids is...
Well, that's a lot of pressure when you're, when you're in a spotlight such as that, and then paparazzi...
It's probably worse than drugs, because it's a mental thing of where no one will say no to you. You have an inordinate amount of money, and you have every imaginable kind of sexual thing being thrown at you for free without any problems or hindrances. You just have no restraint, right? And it's very hard to be normal. I mean, that's the hardest thing to do, is be normal.
Do you think it's part of it too, is when you get to that point where you're on top of the mountain, basically, you're afraid to fall and go backwards?
Well, yeah, because that's why, I mean, you know, you got to ask yourself, why would a guy with $1 billion like Paul McCartney still care? Why would he want to go out and do a new record? He doesn't need the money. But there is a process inside of him that he still believes, and it's true, that his best is yet to come, that he's not done. Because, you know, look at B.B. King, 89 years old, he's still on stage. He doesn't want to die in a nursing home. He wants to die on stage. That's going to go, it's going to go down. The Stones are going out right now, and everybody's like, oh my God, they're 70 years old. You know, instead of the steel wheels, it's the steel wheelchair tour. You know, it's like, but that's all they know. That's what they do. They're gypsies and they're, you know, minstrels that go from town to town. It's like some medieval art, you know?
Well, Emery, what's the music category that you would classify yourself in?
Pushing the rock, edgier rock genre, radio friendly, but trying to push the envelope on that direction.
Mm-hmm. And so, do you have like a little band together and stuff of people that are on the island that are part of your team?
No, living on the island, it was very isolating. Mm. I'm 18 and co-writing is a very new thing for me. I've only done it like three times. And that was all in Nashville. I didn't have a band. I had my guitar teacher and the guy I recorded with. And one of the most exciting things about the next chapter for me is working with the Brotherhood and building, just a dynamite band of young, talented musicians. So that is
of like mind,
Yeah. I like what you're about, Robert. And I like the idea of what you're talking about. Like, you are training for the Olympics. You got to get your body, your mind in tune so that you can be clear.
Absolutely.
When you make your music and the connections you make with the relationships, So,
And one of the questions I get over and over also is I have a lot of young photographers that email me and say, can you give me advice? I want to shoot musicians and how do you break in? And I basically said, you're not going to be able to shoot the Rolling Stones or Green Day. It's not going to happen. You need to find a young artist like an Emery, photograph this person, befriend them, help them, help create their image and ride the rocket ship with them. I do that over and over and over in my life. I mean, there is no way the Rolling Stones are going to let me shoot now. It's a corporate blockage on it. But I can find a young artist like Tyler Bryant or any of these other people, and I can, I can still shoot Joe Bonamassa anytime I want or any of these kids that are starting to come into their own, sick puppies, because they remembered I helped them.
Yeah.
So that way I'm constantly reinventing myself. I'm going to be 65 this year, and probably most people would be retiring, and I'm out trying to find and work with young bands, and I'm in the pit. I'm out there elbow to elbow with everybody.
This guy's got more energy than anybody I know.
Yeah. I'm familiar with shooting in the pit because I like shooting bands too, and I shoot for this local station at times at KXP. But so Emery, what's going on now? What's next for you?
Well, I went to Nashville like a week and a half ago, and I met Patrick Clifford, who is a business partner of Robert, and I found a place to stay. And literally getting off the plane, I end up at BMI and I'm meeting my heroes within the first 2 hours. And now the plan is for me to kind of go to boot camp and spend as much time writing every day with these people that are just fantastic, really honing my craft and getting, a kick-ass catalog.
Yeah, what do you think of Nashville? Does it feel, it's got a whole different vibe than the island.
It does. It does. But, Nashville is such a renaissance right now for the music. Everybody's there. It's not just country. It's everything. Fashion, art, music, movie. It's all there. And I just, when I go to Nashville, what I've realized is a lot of people, they leave Nashville or they leave other places to go write in these bucolic, scenic areas. But I've grown up with that, and I don't take it for granted, but I've grown up with the beauty and the outdoor creative essence. But when I'm in Nashville and I'm sitting in a little black box, that's when I do my best work, because there's competition and there's a buzz.
It's that energy that's around you.
It's the energy. Yeah.
Yeah, to try to make it nowadays, because we, when I meet young artists, I try to tell them, look, here's the deal. There's a lot of good people out there. A few great people. That's not good enough. You have to be undeniable.
Mm-hmm.
And not only do you have to be better, but you have to be better than your heroes. Your heroes are your competition. So if you're a young female and you're going into Nashville, the one that you need to knock off the chart is Taylor Swift. Not be like Taylor Swift. You need to take her out.
Yeah.
Right? But Taylor Swift did that to Britney Spears or Madonna or whatever. It's a constant, never-ending cycle of, hero worship, but then you have to supplant your hero, know? So. Yeah. It's tough, but you have to fall into the undeniable category to make it nowadays. Because it's like winning the lotto, but not just once, several times. Wow. One, being discovered. Two, getting signed. And three, have the record mean anything. Each one of those is like winning the lotto. Mm-hmm. Wow. Tough.
Yeah, it's a tough business.
Tough business.
And you realize that, and you're creating this team.
It's a nasty business too, I mean, it's like I explain to music people. I say, can you swim 100 yards to shore in a lake? Sure, easily, I'm a good swimmer. Okay, if there was 100 sharks between you and the shore, are you that confident? No. Well, that's the music distance, okay? There's those sharks between you and the shark.
It's not that far away, but
yeah, they're there.
You made a comment in that film, and I can't remember what band it was, talking about the more popular we get, the more...
Well, Led Zeppelin actually said that. Okay. Robert Plant said, the more famous we become, the worse the caliber of people we meet.
Isn't that the strangest thing?
Well, people lose their mind when you're really famous. I remember there was a guy here in Seattle named Dick Balsh that had a car dealership, used to smash cars on television with sledgehammers. And he turned up at the Led Zeppelin thing at the Edgewater and basically was out of control. And then, basically they trashed the place and, throwing everything into the Puget Sound. But it was like they were looking, who is this guy? It's like he shows up, he's in their room and just like completely out of his mind.
Wow.
It was a lot of fun.
Yeah, that's why they have big walls around their places and stuff nowadays.
Yeah.
Well, Emery, it was a pleasure meeting you. And
you too.
And you're recording a little bit in the studio, so you'll see that here on our podcast as well, a little sample of your work. So
cool.
Thank you for stopping by today with Robert.
And, thank you.
Much success for you in Nashville. And I'll be keeping an eye on you and seeing where you're at. And hopefully we'll be able to, have you come here and play sometime.
Absolutely. I love that.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
So, Robert, you got another friend here that you found.
Yeah, I was at a Fender event when they opened the Visitor Center about 2 years ago, maybe a year and a half ago. And this extraordinary young female guitar player came out, and it was like watching Keith Urban or watching Brad Paisley play, and my jaw dropped. I had with me a young guitar player that I work with named Josh Gooch, and I've arranged for both of them to come upstairs and kind of jam together. And I was like, oh my God, this is just like, she is unbelievable. And the number of females that can actually play like this that are in the public eye is really rare. They're like Concorde pilots. There's not many of them, right? So it was like I got a hold of her manager and tried to do whatever I could do.
Oh, she's all managed.
She's wired. She's already out working, playing around Canada and won some awards and all these different things. But I needed her as a role model for the Brotherhood because we just don't have that many females. So I asked her to come down today and, hopefully this will help her because she's got a new record that she's doing. And I'll let Haley tell you the rest of the story.
Well, we've got Haley McLean in the studio today. Okay. Thanks for coming down with Robert.
Happy to be here.
Be a part of this. And so tell me, I would like to just know how you guys connected at the very start. How was that?
Was Bill, the head of A&R, said, you got to meet Robert. You got to meet Robert. He's awesome. You guys are going to hit it off. So we met at the Visitor Center, just in Corona, California. And like Robert was saying, I got to play with Josh, who's a great player, and Buddy Guy was there, and Los Lobos was there, and Eddie Van Halen was walking around. So
where are we at again?
The Fender Factory.
So it was quite the experience, especially because Fender is like something that my dad had. I learned on an old Fender acoustic, and my dad would always say, like, people who have real Fenders, those are real good players. So in my mind, it's just like, oh, Fender. So I was there. I was like, whoa, this is crazy.
That's pretty good.
Yeah, I was pretty excited.
So does your parents play too?
My dad plays. He'd be the first to say he's not a great player, but he has a great ear. And the best lesson that I could have ever asked for was teaching me how to learn. So he taught me how to, match the notes from what I was hearing to what I was playing. And that's kind of how I learned, through playing along to albums that my parents had on all the time. And
I'll be damned. So at the Fender, you're talking about all these musicians that are hanging out there. I mean, what were they doing there? They just hang out in the Fender Factory?
No, there was a big event. It was the opening of the Visitor Center. So Fender called all these people. And Steve Miller was there too.
Steve Miller was there. Smoked a cigar with Steve
Who's
Miller,
your neighbor? She's in the San Juans.
Steve Miller lives
out in the San Juans on Orca Island.
I see.
But he was there. Eddie Van Halen was there. Buddy Guy, Haley. They were all playing for Fender. And then they had two nights, I think. One was for all the people that worked for Fender, and then the second one was open to the public. And there were several thousand people there. And wow, Haley imagine. Got up there and rocked out with Buddy Guy, which is interesting.
It was crazy.
Yeah.
Is that the first time you ever played with anybody that caliber?
Oh, yeah, yeah. And it's funny because I had actually named my guitar Buddy Guy like years ago.
That is so weird.
So,
and then
yeah,
all of a sudden, surreal. Here you are playing.
It was very surreal.
I what is that? I mean, it's almost like you set the thing in motion by doing that. Like you
I think so.
You know?
I've always been a very driven person and very goal oriented. And you know, I used to sail really competitively, and it was always just about, okay, this is what I want to do. And just my parents have instilled in me since as far back as I can remember that you can do anything you set your mind to. So I've just chosen to set my mind to certain things. And you know, while naming my guitar, I wasn't thinking, like, if I name my guitar, I'm going to play with Buddy Guy. It was just, I love Buddy Guy. Here's my guitar. And
you set it in motion without you even thinking about it.
Human intention is very powerful. And when you study quantum physics, you'll discover that all time is right now, past, present, and future. There is no linear progression in any direction. So therefore, you get ahead of yourself sometimes. So you take something that hasn't happened to you yet, which actually has happened to you, and you incorporate it in this current reality. So that's why things look entangled later.
There's no such thing as coincidence in my mind.
Yeah, I agree with you on that. I think we create our own. It's all done by power of attraction.
That's right. Human intention.
Yeah.
Even prayer. That's why prayer works.
That's right.
Because,
it doesn't have to be
a religious thing. Yeah. It's just an energy thing.
Right. There is actually a study that I looked at where 10 people were brought off the street and they were put on a table and there was a beaker with a known pH solution in it. And they asked everybody to think about changing the pH factor.
Oh, I love this study.
And they changed it by a factor of 1. So it went from whatever it was down 1. Well, in the human body, if you changed your pH by 0.50, you would die. So it shows you that these 10 people who did not touch the beaker just through intention were able to reduce the pH or increase the pH by intending it to change. So the power, like the people say, oh, power, positive thinking, but it's really using a part of your brain and moving it to the other half of your brain where you actuate. So that's why when you write to-do lists, you tend to do things because you're moving it to the part of the brain to actuate. I've discovered that creative people or musicians have a really natural ability to move from the creative part of the brain to the actuation part of the brain. So they write songs. They don't even know where the lyrics come from.
Yeah.
They literally are channeling. They say, well, I don't know. I wrote that song, but I don't know where it came from. You know, because there's a process going
on. You're tapped in. And I think that's, you know, this is a kind of interesting subject. I know it's not on the topic, but I like this stuff a lot. I mean, I'm all about this stuff. Brad knows it from the beginning.
Yeah.
Is her mic too far from her?
No, you're good.
Okay. Yeah. And so, you know, that's how I created my world is, you know, this is a beautiful space and I have, you know, this amazing product and it's all because of the visualization thing. So I've been in this thing with thinking this way for a little while now. Mm-hmm. And I love it because I think it's, we talk about swimming upstream. There's no reason to swim upstream and fight it. It's like when you know that you're in the pocket of that stream.
It's not work.
It's not work. It feels just like fun. It's like you can't even take. That's probably why Robert really, you don't have an ego, Robert. And it's because I don't know if you're accepting this that's coming to you, whatever is going on in your world is, it's not me. You know, I'm here for the ride, and how can I take?
Yeah, that's the example I use when people write me. They're like, look, if it could happen to me, it certainly can happen to you because there was nothing particularly special about my life. You know, I wasn't gifted. I had struggled in school. I had all the problems that every kid have. But when you sit by the edge of the river and you notice the fast moving stream going by, you also notice that there's these eddies that make it really easy to go upstream, which is how trout and everything, they sense these ripples. So it's very easy to actually go up things that you think are not possible. And I have to be careful, and I always warn the people around me to be careful, what you wish for. Literally, because, you know, I met all my heroes. I literally tracked down. I mean, I went to Spain and knocked on Salvador Dali's door until he came out to meet me when I was a kid. You know, I mean, I made that happen, right? I wanted to work with Jeff Beck. That was the first guy I ever worked with. I mean, you can do it.
16 years old or something.
Yeah, like you know, so it's like he was literally the first. Because he was in the Yardbirds, and that was the band I wanted to work with, you know.
But just real quick to Robert again, and Haley, we'll get to you in a sec.
No, I love this.
I know that when you were younger, Robert, you had this I think you felt like you had this low self-esteem of yourself because everybody felt creative around you.
Yeah.
You didn't feel creative. Do you still feel that way a little bit?
Well, no, it's funny because, you know, I'm a firm believer in making a list of things that you like about yourself and the things you don't like about yourself. So the one thing that really upset me was I never was a musician. So how do I write that? Well, I've become an important part of musicians' lives. That's right. Because I create the visual images for them. So in the sense, I'm able to be in a room with musicians and not feel awkward. But originally it was through the intimidation of not being a musician. And you want to sit in a room with a bunch of guitar players. Now they want me to sit in the room and hopefully take their picture, right? So I've reversed something by taking it the other way.
Nobody can plan what you've created and what you've done in your life. I mean, there's no formula to any of this other than just that magic.
You ride Robert the synchronistic wave. Yeah. The synchronistic wave. That's what I ride.
Yeah.
And one of the greatest psychics in the world, I just did a documentary on, and he says you can tell in life, there's only two things, signal and noise. And when you're on life's correct trajectory, when you're on the signal line, nothing but a constant stream of synchronicity happens in your life. Mm. If you have no synchronicity happening in your life, you're probably not on the signal. You're not on the signal at all.
Yeah.
Yeah. I love that. I
love follow your that bliss too. That's right. You know, I know it's like, it sounds so cliche, but it's so true. You follow something that really strikes a chord with you. There's just bound to be things that come into your path that allow you to continue doing that even more so. You know, it's a constant process of becoming.
Yeah.
Becoming you, something more than what you already are.
And you kind of grew up that way yourself with your parents you were talking about.
Like yeah, my parents like
instilled that in you a little bit.
Pretty much every night before I went to bed, I can think of my mom saying, you can be anything you want to be. Like, if you set your mind to it, that's, you know, if you set your mind to it, you can do anything. A lot of times too, I'd be sitting in the back of the car driving home from somewhere and I'd be like, so does that mean I could fly then if I wanted to? I would be like, well, if you really put your mind to it, I suppose. So it's just kind of ingrained in how I've been brought up.
Yeah. Both of these young ladies are highly independent people and they are self-sufficient. I mean, Haley takes off in a boat and goes to Mexico or, you know, these are people that are takes survivalists.
Off in a boat and goes to Mexico?
Literally survivalists through life.
Sailboat?
Yeah.
Yeah, my family, we lived there for a few years when I was really young, did homeschooling and just cruised around the coast of Mexico and learned how to play guitar and
my did next life
too little school.
And Rihanna grew up with the National Geographic in her house because they raised Paraguay falcons and they trained them to skydive with them. And her father would put a camera on his helmet and they would train the Paraguay falcon to follow the helicopter or the Cessna. And then when he would jump out, the bird would join him and they would dive down together and they clocked one of their birds at 245 miles an hour on the National Geographic Channel. But then you can see this thing and then they would throw out a piece of meat. He would grab it and go back to Rihanna and the mom back at the house. So she raised all of these falcons, but that's pretty much the way she is. She's like this free bird. Sorry, like Leonard Skinner. But yeah.
I know we got on topic. But so what's going on now?
Well, I'm actually just right after this, I'm headed home back to Vancouver to do a couple more sessions.
This
just
is Vancouver, Washington, not BC.
No, BC. I'm Canadian. Okay. Yeah. Finish up my first album, which I'm so stoked about. I'm co-producing it, wrote every song on it, and just means a lot to me. I mean, being in country music, a lot of people can be like, oh, poo-poo country music, and that's fine. You know, I get it. But what I love about country and the writing behind it is that it's like spoken word and that I could read you the lyrics and I could read those same lyrics to the person I was writing it about or the situation and it would make sense. Or if I was talking to a friend, you know, it's very conversational, which I like. And pretty much poured my heart out into this record. So I'm very, very excited for it.
Well, that's very good. And you're going to Nashville as well soon too?
Yeah, I spend quite a bit of time there. It's amazing. I mean, the players are so good. The producers and that whole world really interests me. And that's something that I'd
there's love like over 100 live venues.
Get better at.
You know, there's like 100 venues you can play live music at. So any night of the week, you could go down the street in Nashville and hear blues and rock and country.
Oh, it's crazy.
It's just constant.
Yeah.
It's probably a real tight community too. I mean,
it is.
It's the only industry there. I mean, if you think about it, what else is there to do in Nashville?
Right? It's not all country music too. I mean, I write country music, but I don't, I love the blues. I love all sorts of different kinds of things. And it's just Music City. It really is Music City.
And it's an alternative mecca now because Jack White's moved down there. Yeah. And he's printing vinyl down there. And then you've got the Kings of Leon and Cadillac Black and Hot Chili Ray and all these people coming out of there right now. Huh. And every major record company is in Nashville. Every major publishing company is in Nashville. All the tour support for most major bands in the world are headquartered out of Nashville, Tennessee. All your tour buses are out of Nashville. So it's central to all the rest of the United States. You're halfway.
Yeah, I see.
So it's you know, and it's a small enough town. And people, you know, are accessible. You could call the president of CAA and probably have a meeting with him. I mean, you know, LA, forget it.
Can you still do that?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
So, I've been told it's like LA was 20 years ago. Yeah. Not that I was around then, but.
So it's it still has its simple little life, world, people, connections.
Well, there's a dark side to Nashville, as there is in any industry. There's a probably, but it's probably more hidden than Hollywood because the dark side is really what's front and forward in Hollywood, you know, the decadence. But you don't see the decadence in Nashville so openly like you do in LA. And then also some of the top people in the world of music have moved to Nashville to live. So Aerosmith's living down there right now. You got Larry Carlton and you got Steve Winwood, and I mean, it would blow your mind to know who lives down in Brentwood, Tennessee, or Leaper's Fork, just outside Nashville. It's like the who's who of the world.
It must be a place, too, that they just want to get out of the vibe of all this vibration around all the people.
Well, it's like you elevate your game.
You can get around easy.
Yeah, Johnny Depp just bought a $17.5 million home down there. I have no
idea.
That
must be huge. What that would be.
No, I was like, it must be Brentwood, Tennessee he bought. I'm not sure what he bought, but Johnny's now frequently there, and
well, he's been really kind of, you see him a lot playing music now.
Well,
you
know? I met Johnny when he first hit Hollywood and he got on a TV show called 21 Jump Street. And he was not very happy because he came to LA to make it in a band.
Yeah.
And he got to be on the cover of Tiger Beat magazine in a strange TV show, right? So he never was really happy. But the Disney movies have freed him because he's a front end producer. He gets like, you know, 10% of the gross and not the net. So Johnny's probably close to being a billionaire, literally, and he's now playing music again, and he's having his own personal rock and roll fantasy camp because he's playing with Manson, he's playing with Alice Cooper, he's playing with Aerosmith. He shows up at gigs. He's got one of the best guitar collections in the world. He's bought a bunch of houses in LA. He had Joe Perry living in one of his houses from Aerosmith. I mean, it's a real creative thing going on around Johnny at the moment.
Wow. I didn't know that much about him on that.
And he's a hell of a player.
Yeah.
Is he? That's good to know.
Yeah. I like how he plays that guitar. It's way down low, too. Yeah.
As if he couldn't get cooler.
Right.
Yeah.
And he's got a fashion trend going with the hat now, because like John Mayer bought the hat, and like all these people have the same Johnny Depp hat.
Oh, is that right? Oh,
yeah. The Johnny Depp hat.
I saw him on, I think it was David Letterman, and it looks like he got a new hat because that one with the hole in it, he had a new one but didn't have the hole in it.
He's Tonto in the new Lone Ranger movie.
Oh, that's right.
He's turned Tonto into Dr. John with a headdress and all kinds of strange things, you know.
Yeah.
But a cool cat, you know. I see him around LA, you know, but you leave these people alone. I mean, they don't, you know, just lead everybody and they'll come up to you.
Who was your role model coming up?
Musically?
Yeah.
Well, I listened. My parents listened to a lot of Eagles, so Joe Walsh, Bernie Leadon, that whole band really. That's a lot of the stuff I learned to play too, because that was always on.
Yeah.
A lot of the Eagles, a lot of Beatles. My dad's a huge 50s, 60s doo-wop fan,
right?
A lot of Motown too, a lot of older stuff, and my mom is a big blues fan, so she listened to a lot of Albert King and. And Stevie Ray and B.B. King. She's a huge B.B. King fan.
Wow.
So that kind of amalgamation has...
You had a lot of different types of genres surrounded you growing up.
Yeah, and I still surround myself with a lot of different types of genres. I think it's important to not listening to the other ones so I can, you know, be like not elevating my game for other people other than just, you know, the more input, the better the output. At the end of the day, I think.
Yeah. Well, I'm fascinated by all this and what's going on. And again, we'll follow you too. And, you know, we'll see what's
Thank
up with you.
You.
And I'll keep a tab on Robert and his whole thing that he's got going on. We got Robert Knight here. I'm just so excited today. It was, you know, you're everything that I thought you would be in person. I like the way you think. You're a big believer in, you know, basically the power of attraction. You've attracted so much coolness around you. I mean, no one could write a script and believe this unless it was real from you, what you've done in your life. And it keeps getting more exciting for you. You said you're 65 years old and you're still going, and you're still excited about music and photography, just like, you know, you were as a teenager.
Yeah, and like, you know what? I can't take a day off, because if I took a day off, I'd probably bring my cameras and go hear live music. So it's like, I might as well get paid for it, right? Or might as well do it for a living.
That's true.
Yeah.
Well, it was a pleasure having you come down, and you brought the girls with you, and we'll follow them and see what's going on. And the Brotherhood of the Guitar is the name of your
website.
Website.com. And you can check that out on the bottom of this podcast here. And much success to you, as if you don't already have it or need it. But it was a pleasure you stopped by.
Thank you, and I've enjoyed you hosting us here and appreciate it.
All right. Thanks, Robert.
Thank you.